By now, you have probably had the opportunity to review some mathematical topics that will help you in this course. And in the first chapter of the chemistry textbook, it's kind of a hodgepodge of information that basically gets us thinking about science in general. So we'll talk about things like states of matter, solid, liquid, and gas, classifications of matter, the scientific method, significant figures, using significant figures in calculations, dimensional analysis, density, and several other things that will just kind of get us thinking about how science works, or how scientists perform scientific experiments to some extent. And it's kind of a good opportunity to kind of get us immersed in this material. But before we do that, I just wanted to spend a few minutes talking about some of the essential ideas of chemistry and why we bother to study chemistry in the first place. So chemistry is really the study of matter. And matter is anything that has mass and takes up space. And chemistry really seeks to understand how we can change and manipulate matter in ways that are advantageous for us. For example, if you take some hydrocarbon, like in a fossil fuel, and you want to turn it into plastic, something that's useful to make cars and cell phones and many, many other things that are made of plastic, these are very important things. And without chemistry, we wouldn't be able to do these things. Matter is made up of tiny particles, which we call atoms. And on a periodic table, you could find a list of all of the atoms known to man. There are approximately 110 atoms on the periodic table. And this is just one example of a periodic table that was found online. And these 110 atoms make up all of the matter that you will ever interact with. In fact, they make up all the matter that makes up you. You are an organic thing, which means that you are made of carbon, with the exception of the fact that you're mostly water. But carbon is one of the major molecules that makes up people. So these are just the different atoms that are known to man, and different combinations of these atoms make up all of the things that you've ever seen. If you simply look at what's around you right now, you could probably find more than 110 different materials, even though there's only approximately 110 atoms on the periodic table. That's because these can combine in many different, unique, and interesting ways, and chemists seek to understand these ways. One thing that's really important to point out about chemistry and science in general is it's not about human beings making the rules. So for example, if humans decide that cars have gotten safer, so the speed limit can go from 65 miles an hour to 75 miles per hour on the highway, humans can change the rules. But when it comes to chemistry, nature makes the rules. Chemists and scientists in general just seek to understand the rules that nature has made. And we develop very clever experiments in order to understand these rules better. So these atoms can combine together, as I said, to form molecules. And when there's enough molecules present, we can see them, which leads us to this distinction between the macroscopic and microscopic world. And really, chemistry occurs at the submicroscopic level. So the great example of this is on the next slide, which is water. We've all seen water, right? We can all envision what a cup of water looks like. And this is kind of the macroscopic view of water. However, there is also this microscopic, or I would argue, submicroscopic view of water, where we have an oxygen attached to two hydrogens. It's interesting to note that the water molecules, even if this wasn't being poured into a glass, even if this was just a bottle of water that you may have sitting in front of you right now, as long as the temperature is above absolute zero, all of those water molecules are moving. And those water molecules are attracted to each other. And there's a distance between the oxygen and the hydrogen. And there's a bond angle between hydrogen, oxygen, and hydrogen. And all of these things that seem small and subtle actually affect the properties of water. It's actually quite remarkable that water is a liquid at room temperature. Most small molecules, like water, are gases at room temperature, but water is not. And all of the information that's provided on this slide, when combined with some other information, allows us to know why, or attempt to explain theoretically, why water is actually a liquid at room temperature, which is probably a big deal because it's probably the reason that we're here. So these things all come together in very complex and interesting ways. One last example that I want to show you is an example of a combustion reaction. So in a combustion reaction, we could have a hydrocarbon, like for example, CH4, which is methane. We can add to it oxygen, which is found in the atmosphere, and we can make more stable molecules, carbon dioxide and water. So methane is about 85% of natural gas. And I will note, I have not included states of matter, and this is not balanced for those of you who have had chemistry before. We'll get to that later. But we have methane plus oxygen yields carbon dioxide and water. And there are actually vehicles that run on this. This is how I heat my house. So why is it that this combination of carbon bonded to four hydrogens is less stable than carbon bonded to two oxygens? And humans take advantage of this difference in stability, this molecule being less stable than this molecule. And when we perform this reaction and form these more stable molecules, we use that energy to, for example, heat our house or to propel a car down the road. And gasoline is just more complex hydrocarbons. There's more carbons and more hydrogens, but it's essentially the same idea. So what we're going to do in this course is study some of these fundamental ideas so that we have a better understanding of how nature works and then how we can take advantage of nature in order to manipulate it in a way that's good for us. Finally, the last thing that I'd like to mention is chemistry is a central science. I'm under no illusion that all students taking this course are interested in being chemists. My guess is that many of you are taking this because it's required for something else. But whether you're interested in biology, medicine, physics, earth science, or even politics, or history, or something like this, chemistry is involved in our lives in many, many ways, whether it's the production of carbon dioxide, a fossil fuel, whether it's which elements are used in modern batteries. There are many ways that chemistry impacts all of us. And it's very important that we all have, it would be a good idea if we all had some basic understanding of chemistry so we can see how it will, how the rules influence all of us, because it's literally everything all around us, and chemistry is happening all of the time.